There we are. It's the summer solstice. It's the longest day of the year. This won't be the longest episode, you'll be happy to hear, but this is sort of like a midsummer Reds Report special. Plenty has happened, and we hope plenty will still happen before the preseason. So we thought it was time to get Steve out of bed, and he can give us his opinions of everything that's been happening at Oakwell. And a man that we've seen more and more on social media, not only on his Tykes blog, but we've seen him on... right, come on, Ian. You've been on Tykes TV a couple of times, haven't you?
I have, yes. Yes. Yeah.
And
I wouldn't go as far as saying I'm an internet sensation, but, you know.
No. But you're halfway to being an influencer now, I think. I think that we can
agree with that, Tan. Definitely.
Can I get paid now?
Not yet. Maybe with the others. Ask Tykes TV, because they've probably got more money than we have. And gents, disastrous season over and done with. We stopped that.
Yeah,
and
move on.
We said towards the end of last season that, you know, changes needed to be made, and then the announcement about the reshuffle of the board. So gone are Lee and Conway, still in the club, but haven't got a sort of like a vote to decide things on a day-to-day basis. And I think the biggest change or positive change the board could have made, and they have made, is Gene Crine coming on board. And as we know, Patrick's wife, widow, Patrick bled Barnsley FC. And I would presume that both of you are extremely happy with the appointment of Gene and a Barnsley FC fan almost back on the board. You go first, Ian.
I completely agree. I think the biggest thing was Conway going, such a divisive figure. Yes, he is still owns, I can't remember if it's 8% or whatever he owns, but he's not involved in the day-to-day running, which clearly, as we look back now, he made some horrendous mistakes, didn't he, with some of the signings, with tactics, with his ripping up the data-driven policy and various faux pas that he did. So, and the place seems to have a better atmosphere, and there seems to be better communication between the club, the board, and the fans now, which small steps, but that seems to be the most positive that he's gone. And like you say, the ones who've come in, Gene Crine and... I mean, the chairman's been around a bit, but he's been quite vocal. They've come out and done some really good press conferences. So, yeah, it is. It is positive.
Steve, we went to a briefing or whatever with Paul Conway. It was sort of like early on in the season, wasn't it? Last season, we were quite taken in by him, weren't we? He was a very, powerful figure. Spoke with passion. His words were exactly what we wanted to hear, but his actions have been completely the opposite, haven't they?
No, when you listen to him, and you know, he obviously talked the talk, but you know, you don't get to a job like that by not having some silver pipes that can charm ducks off water. And yeah, he said what we wanted to hear, but the difference now is, the people that are saying things that we want to hear are actually putting, you know, money where their mouth is and actually doing something about it. Where Conway, it's prime example of somebody getting involved in a football club that has not a clue about football. I know we bang on about it being a business. We know it's a business, but he was using it. I don't know. Was he using it as a stepping stone to something bigger? Was he just feeding his own ego? Who knows? But yet again, somebody in football who hasn't got a clue what they're doing. And unfortunately, we get the residue of that.
Yeah. You said earlier, Ian, you know, they've given some really good press conferences. And, you know, as the on the badge it says, doesn't it, judges by our actions. If we're going to do that, the appointment of Michael Duff... that's a home run, isn't it? As it comes to appointments, one of the most promising young coaches, rather than, you know, a part-time shelf stacker and PE teacher from Estonia, for instance. Is it away from the normal recruiting model, or does he fit in the model, or is it actually learning from previous mistakes, do you think?
Could be a bit of everything, really. I think there's I'd like to think there's learning from the previous mistakes. The appointments of Shoppen as bargain must have burnt the fingers massively. I mean, well, we got relegated, haven't we? So, but I think must be a wake-up call, surely. I'm glad that they've got their first choice target. I've been impressed with what I've read about him, when I've heard him speak. I like what he kind of stands for. I like how his teams are super fit, and I think he'll work this squad out very quickly. And I think he's almost been a little bit Val-esque, Big Val, in terms of he quickly worked his team out and shipped out the ones that weren't prepared to pull the finger out, and he knew who the ones who were going to work with him.
Yeah.
And he moulded that team, and I can see that in Duff. So yeah, a great appointment. No complaints really for me for that.
When asked about what we can expect, Steve, when Michael Duff was asked, what can as fans, what we can expect, and he said, sweat under shirts. I mean, that's how you get fans on side, isn't it, at your first press conference? I mean, it's a sentence, but that's actually backed up by what he did at Cheltenham, wasn't it? Because that team, like you say, they were super fit, a never-say-die attitude, working for each other on the pitch. That's what every Barnsley fan wants for our team, isn't it?
Well, you listen to the couple of press conferences that he's done already, and the way he speaks, the way he puts himself across. You know, he's only ever been with two clubs, so that shows dedication, loyalty. He's played in all eight leagues of football, so that shows that, you know, he's got some fighting in him. You know, he can self motivate. And he can put that across to his players. For me, how can a Barnsley fan at all now complain? Because we basically got what we wanted. Young English manager, knows the leagues, up and coming, with a pedigree, not necessarily in management, but definitely in playing in his Burnley days. No-nonsense centre-half. Going to be a no-nonsense manager, you can see that. And, you know, he started off on right foot, and that I think that's now creating, this is the excitement that we felt, probably more so than when Val took over, because we didn't know anything about Val. That came as the games progressed. But now, everything that's gone on with the board, everything that's gone on with Duff, and what's going on now at the ground, people are gaining that excitement again, and I think it is running through the town.
About 4 or 5 years ago, in an interview, Martin Devaney was asked to put together his dream 11 of players that he played with, and he put Michael Duff in a centre-back, and I'm not sure if he made him captain, and talked about his attitude, his leadership and everything. So that relationship, I mean, the young lads that we've got that have come up from the academy, new players coming in and existing players, if that chemistry is there because they've played together, they know each other, they've talked a lot before obviously you got appointed, that's a winning start. Because often I feel we've had coaches that might have had a really good pedigree, but they need to get used to the town, get used to the language, as silly as it sounds, the accents, how everything is, visas, everything else. He is ready to go, isn't he? He's obviously he's already. And he talked about this being a stepping stone. He says his next step was always, he's only had two clubs in his career, he says, Burnley and Cheltenham. And I think the fact that he sees this as a step up, but not the final destination in his coaching career, it's another step up. That's great, isn't it? Because if he wants to prove himself, then that can only be for our benefit. And a 3-year contract, Ian, club put a little bit of faith in him as well, haven't they?
Yeah, I do agree with the link with Devaney. I think that's going to be pivotal. And I'm sure, I sense from what Duff has come out and said, he's clearly done his own work. He said he spoke to the chairman a couple of times, Cauley a few times. He'll have spoken to Devaney probably for hours.
Ben Williams apparently gave a glowing reference of the club.
So he'll know a bit about the academy. He'll know about because he talked about how the board or the club and the fans has been fractured. So he wants to build that bond. So he's aware of that. He says, you know, the board have accepted that they've made decisions, and but he knows which way the board are going. So he's not coming into this with his eyes closed or been sold something that then the rug's going to be pulled on from under him. He'll have spoken to Devaney and he'll give him a clear picture. So one, he's walking into it with his eyes wide open, but I think also two, he's got somebody there. Certainly if results are not going well, he's got a mate who he knows who he can bounce off as well.
Yeah.
Steve, and I'll come back to you with the same question as well, Ian. What's more important? Immediate sort of promotion back up to the championship, or you know, the gap, the fracture between the fans and the club, and that feeling of feeling distance from the club, to try and bring that back together? What would be seen as a successful first year? I mean, ideally both, and I'm sure one will help the other, but how important is it that he helps sort of, you know, repair that bond between the clubs and the fans? Because we've been, you know, through the mill, haven't we? And a lot of fans have said, like, that's it for me, no more. So how important is it for him to repair that relationship again?
I think, you know, everybody wants us to get back up first time. But you know what? I think we need to be looking at stability first. We need to be looking at getting together a squad of players that actually want to play together. Because, I mean, people are going to be leaving this summer. We need to be replacing them. And you need him to be putting a team together that is exactly what it says on the tin, is a team. Because if you get a team that Barnsley folk can get behind and can see that there is sweat on shirt, that they are fighting for each other, that will automatically generate that interest with the fans, bring the fans back in. That then, you know, builds up the players to want to play. It's, you know, it's a circle that they both motivate each other. If we go back up this first time, fantastic. But I don't think we should set our sights, to be honest, that high to start with. I think we really need to give him time. He might have 12 months and we might end up mid-table and you might think, oh dear, I don't know if he's right man for the job. You know, they wondered whether Alex Ferguson worked right man for the job at one point at Man U, but they stuck with him and give him time. I think that's part and parcel of the problem with football at the minute. There's that much money in it. People want instant success. They're not prepared to sort of let somebody run the club as they want to and give them that time to do it. But I think in Michael Duff, we've got a guy here who we can say, right, he's got a three-year contract. Hopefully he'll stay for 3 years. Hopefully he'll stay for maybe even more, to build up his reputation and to build up Barnsley Football Club. And then he can go and he's done what he said he wants to do, and he'll have left us in a far, far better position.
Yeah. What about you, Ian? Because you don't want him to do a Val, do you? Success, just missing out on the playoffs or whatever, then going, and then it was literally one step forward, four steps back. The board says they've learned from their mistakes, but surely it needs to be a gradual growth, doesn't it? And it's okay, yeah, going to the championship, it's retaining that position for, yeah, maybe more than two or three seasons.
It's difficult because the club has historically sold off its crown jewels, hasn't it, to survive. And I think, yeah, you've mentioned a few times, probably the most we've got through money-wise has been from sell-on fees for the managers, yeah, in Struber and Val. I think if you got promotion, that would build the bond between club and fans, because not as many were moaning about Conway and that when we've got to the playoffs, sure, but it only comes when we're on a bad run. We know that. And I looked at his points per game, and potentially he could get 70, 71 points with Barnsley if he got his points per games that he got at Cheltenham. But he'd be working with a better squad, so I'd like to think he could get more, so he could potentially be pushing for top six. But like you say, there's no point in going up to then come flying back down, or go up and then he's sold on. So quite a lot of fans, I think, are quite realistic and say top 10 and have a good solid season and build on from them. But like Steve says, there's no patience in football anymore, is there? You know, Guardiola got slated in his first season at City because he was trying to teach some of them players how he wanted to play out from the back, and they didn't get it for 12 months. And then suddenly it clicked and he got the right players in. So, and like you said, with Ferguson as well, it took 4 or 5 years for him to really turn things around. So, yeah, we'd all love to go up straight away, or at least have a push for it. But in the reality is there's going to be a lot of turnover in the staff on and off the pitch, but certainly on the pitch. And these players are going to take time to bed in, aren't they, the ones that are coming in?
Yeah.
So, yes, I'd love to hope for a decent push, but be realistic enough to think if he has us top 8, 9 and playing some decent football, and if the fans can see something building and you can see what he's trying to do, they'll buy into it and it'll snowball from there, won't it?
Yeah.
The problem we had was with Shop and Asbaghi, you just couldn't see what on earth was going on.
No.
And it was clear that the players didn't know either. And that's what was frustrating, that we were almost building a house on sand, weren't we?
Yeah. Before I go, before we talk about players coming in, players coming out, for me, I think it's all about his man management skills. If he can get some of these players producing the football they did under Val, if you look, and I don't want to, you know, single players out, but I think
you do want to single players.
It's well documented that
for the change, he's got splinters up his backside.
we've had players on the Val that looked like world beaters that let's say underperformed consistently last season, and I will pick out, because at the end of the 2021 season, everybody was saying, you know, if we keep hold of Britain, if we keep hold of this, if we keep hold of that. Hellick, I think you have to presume, will probably leave, because that's a big money player that we probably can, you know, make up the shortfall from television revenue going down from the Championship to League One. If Michael Duff is the man manager people say he is, and he can get people like Britain performing to that level, you know, we've not got, if you look on paper, besides the players that have left, it's not a bad squad, but it's all about the confidence that's been dinted so much. The players lost their identity. They lost, at times, it feels like the fight to play for the badge. I mean, Ian, you said, and you'll remember the interview that Britain gave one, saying, you know, we need to practice more than what we do up the pitch, because it feels like we're getting here and we're just, you know, making it up as we go along. Yeah. I mean, that cuts deep down, doesn't it, for fans, but as well as players. Players coming in, goalkeeper, Jamie Searle, 21 years old. So who's leaving then? Collins? Walton?
Well, Walton's folks live not far from me, and my neighbour knows his dad, and apparently he's not been happy last season because he weren't getting game time and he was looking to go away, but they didn't release him because obviously in case Collins got injured. So is he going to want to go? Whereas Collins, you'll get a decent fee for. You won't get much for Walton, no disrespect to him, because he's not played enough, but he weren't happy. I don't know, is the honest answer. You don't know who's put their hands up and says, I don't want to be here. I know some have, but I don't know. I don't know what Steve thinks about who's going to be number one next season.
I think you mentioned Hellick. Hellick's got to go. Because if he wants to maintain his international career with Poland, he ain't going to get picked playing for a first division side. So Ellick, for me, will be first. Well, one at first, one's through the door, definitely. And like you say, money, you would think, would be there for him. Styles has obviously made rumblings that he wants to go, which, you know, you don't. If they come out and say, I don't want to be here, for me, they can go. I don't care who they are or how good they are. If they say, you know what, I'm looking for a move, fine, just go. Simple as that.
Styles is probably, in Styles' defence, probably the same. You know, he's got his career off now with Hungary. I mean, they did the double over your lot. You know, he wants to
maintain... Your lot? What's this your lot? What joint shirt? Look at that. He's got a stain on his shirt.
But,
isn't it?
So, but for Styles, you can understand, can't you? He's got that dual nationality. He's been picked for Hungary. You know, we started a couple of times. If you look at press conferences, you know, he's impressing the coach and everybody. He'll want to play in at least the Championship to maintain that position, won't he, Ian?
Yeah, but then Duff's come out, hasn't he? And he said some of these players think they should be playing in the Championship, but they're actually in League One. You need to start proving that you are a Championship player. And I like that. I like the fact that I think he's going to go through this squad and I think he's going to sort out some bluffers. And he's already said what he's going to tell these players what he expects of them, and some of them are not going to like it. And I'm thinking, as a fan, I'm thinking, this is what I want to hear. Some will need an arm around him, like Val did, and some need a kick up the backside, and Val did that as well. And I think my impression is that Duff will get that balance quite right, and he might put a few noses out of joint. But if the club don't get the bid, and you think you're a bit of a Johnny come lately, and you're going to go, you're a championship too big for your boots, and well, sorry, you're not going if we don't get a bid, and you're starting in August against Exeter or Cheltenham or somebody, aren't you? And you just have to put up with it.
And it's funny that Steve mentioned Styles, because the three players are brought in. So goalkeeper, we're saying it could be Walton or a Collins, probably get a better fee. Luke Connell, 21-year-old midfielder on a free from Celtic. Is that maybe a diamond in the rough, but a potential replacement for Styles? And obviously, Robbie Cundy, hopefully signing tomorrow or the day after, but by all accounts, that's almost done. 25-year-old defender. Is he taking Halleck's place? You know what I mean? It almost feels like they're bringing him in before we take him out, which in a way is good as well, isn't it?
Well, that's the way you'd hope the club would do it, wouldn't they? Yeah. Because we don't know when some of these players are going to be sold. They could be sold on the last minute, and the last day of the transfer window, then you've got no chance to go and shop around. So if you can afford it, get your replacements in, and then you go, right, we've got our replacements. Now we'll have a bidding war now for that player. Yeah. In the perfect world.
Yeah. I'm going to say normally we get shut and we have three or four gaps, and then it's Barnsley as a club then that's struggling to fill them gaps, and we get players in that we think can play in that position or we think can do that particular job. But five or six games into the season, then you realise maybe they're not the player that we wanted.
But they must have, to get these transfers in very quickly, they've clearly been watching these players, haven't they, for some time. So it's not like they've suddenly gone, he'll do. So it does sound like they've done the homework.
Well, you'd think that, I mean, Michael Duff's not been here long enough. I'm guessing he will have had some say in it to a certain extent. But like you say, I think these deals were probably in pipeline before Duff were announced.
I saw an article today. Maybe that
were part of the what brought him in. Maybe he's looked at these players and thought, you know, we're showing some sort of initiative and these are good players that he wants to work with.
Apparently he's a big fan of Robbie Cundy and he's been watching him before, so it could well be that.
No relation to Jason, is he?
I don't know, mate. Maybe ring him.
Well, you won't know about English football anyway, so I'll ask Ian if we're playing that game.
Ian, do you think, so the fans have been extremely impressed, the board talks very highly of Michael Duff. Do you think that there'd be any of these players that were in two minds whether to stay or not will have been sold and think, actually, you know what, this is a good appointment and he's going to get me in the next step of my career? Is that possible, you think? Because we didn't have any identity playing style. We offered very, very little the whole of last season. Do you think it's a boost for the players as well that an English manager's coming in that's get go from day one? He knows the current interim head coaches in Martin Devaney. Is it a boost for the players as well?
I'd like to think so. I think if some have made the mind up to go, they've made the mind up. But I think, you know, you look at your likes of your Jordan Williams, who's coming back, maybe your Callum Brittons, those who are likely to stay and probably play regularly. I'd like to think they'll look at him and go, I can work with him. And he's a motivator. He's young. He's got some fresh ideas. He's not some guy who's come from, like, say, the back of beyond. And with no, you Google them and you don't even know who they are. So I think for majority of the squad who are going to be staying, I'd like to think so, yeah.
Let's talk about, we know we've got two in, another one hopefully tomorrow. Players that have left so far, well, Patrick Schmidt, George Miller. We saw very little of him. George Miller, bless him, been loaned out more, and he signed for Doncaster. Patrick Schmidt re-signed for the club that we bought him from. Good luck to him. I mean, never really got a consistent run, did he? And I think there is a footballer in there. I don't think it was ever championship level, but, you know, you want to play football. He's going back to his homeland. Great, isn't it? Can we please have a discussion, a sensible discussion? I do not understand, and I posted it literally, I think, half an hour ago in one of the Barnsley FC fan groups. Somebody put, hooray, Woodrow gone. Is it me? And Steve knows I don't even play that well. Your top goal scorer, the fact that he might have not been a fantastic captain, you can't take that away. If somebody says you want to be captain, you turn it down, you get slated. If you take it to your own form, you get slated. He has been injured. For me, he's been consistently the one striker or player we can rely on to get goals. And yes, I know some of them have been penalties, but somebody has to take them. And I can't remember him missing many, if any. No. Why would people be happy to see Woodrow leave? Because to me, Woodrow, I mean, Steve, we had discussions a couple of days ago. Woodrow in League One, he'd be on fire, wouldn't he? Obviously, he left. And good luck to him. Good luck. Back down south. Luton, good club. Similar to Barnsley, I suppose. You know, why would people be happy that somebody like Woodrow leaves? I don't get it.
No, it beggars belief to a certain extent, doesn't it? I mean, people are saying that he had a bad season last season. I ain't being funny. I can pick 17 players that had bad season last season. But over the last 4 years, he's been one of the best strikers we've had at Oakwell. But we are to doubt. For a good season and a half, he played in a position that weren't really his strongest position. And he ran his blood to water in them games because he were playing up front. He played left wing, right wing. He were knocking ball forward, thinking he were going to run onto it himself because there were never anybody up there to help him. And when he, you know, last season, like I said, we know it were poor. We know it were poor. There's no point going back over it. But some of them games, he did try to pull the team together. Personally, I'm not a fan of a striker being captain. It don't fit right for me. I'd rather have perhaps a centre half, maybe a defensive midfielder that's a cap that can actually see game in front of them and not what's coming towards them. And I think that were a little bit worked in detriment to him. Yeah. I think it held him back a little bit. But like you say, if somebody says, "Do you want to be captain?" You're not gonna turn it down. But anybody who can turn around and say, you know, "Oh, I'm glad he's gone. He's not done this. He's not done that other." They want to give their head a wobble. I just don't get it. They obviously have been watching different game to what I've been watching. They must have. I wish him well. Great servant at club. Yeah, I think he could have done well in first division. But you know what? If he's got another season or two seasons in championship, don't matter who it's with, best of luck to him. Best of luck to him.
Ian? He'll be missed, won't he? Because we've got Carlton Morris, we've got Leia Saker, Ulari is on loan in Belgium. Personally, hope he stays there, but they might bring him back. You've got Devante Cole. Besides Morris, none of them have really set the, you know, anything on fire. We know Duff likes to play with two up front. Is that a new signing that's needed, or can you see one of those maybe partnering Morris up front as we start life in League One?
No, I think they need a new striker. I wrote about it today about Woodrow, and I think I completely concur with what Steve says. He scored double figures in the league. I only looked at his league figures, but double figures for every season. Whether that was a season where we only just stayed up on the last kick of the mat season, kick of the game at Brentford. So even in tough seasons, he's got double figures. And he scored over 50 goals for this club. And I think anybody who does that deserves all the plaudits.
Bearing in mind, he was injured, wasn't he, for the first three? Yeah. Did he get injured during his medical or whatever?
I think he started, was it September, November time or something? It was late on in that season under Stendhal. And he worked with Kiefer Moore really well. And I think maybe the timing's right. Maybe he needs a fresh start. Maybe he's probably one of the top earners. He might free up some cash to bring in a couple of players. It might be the right time, but I think we've missed a trick in the fact that Duff plays 3-5-2 and he always looks better in a 2. And we might have missed a trick there. And Morris can get his injuries because he puts himself about. If he gets injured, we're knackered. Because Devante, not being disrespectful, but Cole, Adebayo, them two are not going to score enough goals, nowhere near enough goals. And if Woodrow would get in League One, as long as you keep him fit, 15 to 20 goals next season. And so that straight away, you've got to find those goals, haven't you? Yeah. And I think they'll only do that by getting another striker.
I always think, and it might be the wrong way of thinking, but I always think when especially a striker or a player's been loaned out a couple of times and nobody comes in to buy him. And I know we don't always hear about it or it's been turned down, but Adebayo's been away on loan quite a bit, but he always comes back, doesn't he? And then he gets a bit of a run and then he doesn't. And I think the work rate is there. You know, the heart's in the right place. It's just sometimes his first touch lets him down, his awareness. And he always just seems a couple of leagues behind anybody else that's playing up front. Can you remember on the Val, we had six forwards and we could change them at any given time. And
yeah.
I just always felt that he just needed more. I've always felt he needed to go out on loan somewhere and play 40 matches in a season and refine his skill. There might be a player in there, but he's one of two. Palmer, the other one, that's been offered new deals, but have not reported as yet for pre-season training. Is that a loss, Steve, or how do you view it, Palmer and Adebayo?
I don't think Adebayo will be a loss if he don't come back. You mentioned another player who's in Belgium. I don't recognise him. I don't know who that is.
He's on about $7,000 a week, though, apparently.
Yeah, that figure's done it. Well, that's sort of stupid thing that Conway did, weren't it? You know what I mean?
Yeah, yeah. So,
Rommel Palmer, to me, is a bit of an enigma.
Mm.
Season before last, he played really well in midfield. Played really well, and there looked to be a player in there.
Yeah.
But last season, they all had a bad season, but he was definitely one of the worst. And you would have thought, as a young lad, maybe the motivation wasn't there, and maybe he needs that motivation. But the thing is, if he's not come back to pre-season training, that tells me that if that motivation is not there, then, well, we don't want him back.
No.
I mean, Isika as a striker, I've still not, you know, he's played more games than Alari has, but I still haven't seen anything from him, really. Take Morris out at mix.
I don't think
we need one striker. I think we need another two, possibly even three. Mm. However, I mean, what's happened with that young lad that we bought from Scotland that's been out on loan for 2 years?
What
do we know about him? Do you know what I mean? It's stuff like that. Why do we ever buy players to loan them straight out again, not see them for 2 years, and then nobody talks about him? Does that mean he's not any good? I know he's not been pulling any trees up as such, but I don't get the reasoning behind getting players like that, loaning them straight out. I think we need at least another two strikers and proven goal scorers as well, to be quite honest.
I mean, you've got Aidan Marsh in from the academy, haven't you? But and I know people want to chuck him in, but you've got to be wary of chucking young lads in, haven't you?
Yeah.
And you end up a bit like what happened to Kitchen and Moon last season. They have a bit of a poor run. The goals dry up for him, and you can break a player so young like that. So I think a couple of substitute cameo appearances, throw him in the odd Papa John's or something, I don't know. Give him a bit of game time, a bit of a taste of the playing for the first team. But I wouldn't throw him in and play him 40, 50 games next season, whereas you would with Morris. So, yeah, I agree. Jury's still out on a couple of the sort of squad players up front, and I'm still waiting to see. I think Adebayo Asia, I think, is I thought
his time's level. Up. Time's yeah. up now. Got I think to be.
League Two level, maybe League One, I don't know, but it's a trier, and that's as much as you can say.
It just always felt that we played at a higher level than what he was at, and he was sent out alone and then came back, and even when we went down, he didn't sort of pick up.
He's only good for scoring against Derby County.
Yeah, I think what you've got to look at as well, we talk about strikers, but I think we need to be creating more goals from midfield as well, which is something else that we've missed out on. I mean, if style goes, fair enough. You look at Herbie Kane had a good season at Oxford. For me, I would have thought he'll be gone because he was the only saleable asset that we had that were doing any good. But he's had that injury, which I think turned out not to be as serious as first thought. So you've got him coming back. Josh Benson, again, seems to be forgotten about, but he was, you know, first couple of games he played, wow, we all thought there's a player in there.
Yeah.
And then somebody flicked a switch and, you know, it just didn't happen. I think we need to be looking now. You know, we need to be creating goals, not just relying on strikers and talking about strikers. We need backup, and we need, I'm sure Duff will play that sort of style with five in midfield, one or two then pushing forward. But I think that's where some more goals have got to come from.
Is it fair to say that we can only hope that a team could be built around sort of Anderson, Kane, Benson in a central midfield and Morris up front? If that's your spine, we can then build out from there. And that, on paper, for League One is pretty promising, isn't it? Or is Anderson maybe one of them that...
No, I think for me, I don't know what Ian thinks. My spine for next season would be Anderson, Wolf and Morris, because I think Wolf is a player and yeah. I think he will be a player as well. And for me, that they'd be first three names on team sheet for me next season.
Yeah, no, I agree. I think Anderson's likely to stay. Wolf's got a great engine on him. He chases everything down. I think I'm hopeful with Benson because I think Duff sort of talk to him and get him to go to Burnley. And he, like I say, when he started Benson, he was spraying ball around. I thought he's a great player here. Yeah. And then he had a bit of COVID. I think he got COVID, a bit of injury. Didn't work out with shop and stuff. But I think as a spine, I agree. Morris up top, Wolf sort of in the engine room, and Anderson at the back. And then obviously we don't know who the keeper's going to be. But if it was Collins, it'd be great. But yeah.
Would you agree with me in then as well that I personally would give Anderson captaincy?
Yeah, I would. I agree with you that I've never been a fan of strikers having captaincy. I think somebody who's at the back who can read the game better rather than somebody who's up front, as always, whether that's an old school view or not, I don't know. But I think somebody who can see the game ahead of them, whether it's a central midfielder or a centre half or a goalkeeper even, has got a bit captain, really. And I think Anderson's now been there long enough that he would be one of the older heads in the experience in the changing room as well, to speak to some of these young lads as well. Yeah, definitely nailed on for me, with Helic likely to go.
Finally, then, gents, another discussion that is taking place on social media. Looking
Stop
forward
smiling
to
yourself before you start.
Right, Ian, in fact, I'll ask you both, because, you know, this is a podcast, we might as well come out with it. So I'll go first. I am a firm favourite of getting rid of Timerider. My reason being, if you want to create an atmosphere, that doesn't create an atmosphere. You might as well be at the ballet in some sort of museum or some sort of musical theatre in the West End. Where
since
you're
when have you been to ballet? Tell me when you've been to ballet.
Is it cultured?
That's what he says.
You know what I say about Dutch people? No, so I listen, love him or hate him, but a lot of clubs are known for the anthems. You talk about Liverpool, hate Leeds United, but look at what they create. West Ham, forgot the blowing bubbles, but look what it does and look what it creates. The two Sheffield clubs, you know, love them or hate them, but they get the atmosphere right. It's intimidating when you walk out of that tunnel and 20, 30,000 people. I'm not saying we're going to get 20 or 30, but to me, let's say 8,000 people singing would be a lot better than 8,000 people, and most of them clap out of tune, which is a pet hate of mine. So, first of all, Steve, Timerider in or out?
Out. Ian? Time's moved on. It's a classic. It's been well loved, but everything in life now is changing. Things are moving forward. Let's move forward and get something in that creates, like you said, that atmosphere.
Ian, I mean, when I say in or out, you could use it leading up to a big song if you wanted to, just to get people ready. But how do you feel about Timerider, and should it now be replaced? Is the time right? A new looking board, you know, a new manager in, a new era, hopefully. Does that mean a new entrance song as well?
I agree. I like Timerider. I get what you're saying about the clapping. I'd like to keep it somewhere in the pre-match build-up, but not as the main as they're in the tunnel. And you need an anthem that kicks in when you know that they're all in the tunnel ready to come out, that stirs everybody. So I agree. It just needs to be slowly, a bit like retirement, slowly retire it out to about 2:45, 10:03, not at 2:55.
Because from a technical viewpoint, when the players come out of the tunnel, if you're not singing, but the first thing they hear is the away end cheering, that's the first thing they hear because they're closest to them. So anyway, Ian, Steve has got a song. Now, there might not be any lyrics, but we have tweeted, and the Rosa Dogs, who are a South Yorkshire or Barnsley-based sort of indie band, have said they're up for listening to a piece of music and maybe changing some of the wording. So I'm gonna share a couple with you. I'll do Steve first. So let me have a look. So this is one that Steve thought would really create an atmosphere.
Yeah.
You don't really need a song sheet to shout na 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 na. Barnsley.
You guys. Need a song sheet for that. How long do I let it play, Steve?
Oh, about an hour, innit? Well, let's face it, for a song to come out to, you're only ever going to play the first 2 or 3 minutes. So you don't want something that takes 5 minutes to build up.
But I think with that,
it actually is.
That song does build up and build up, doesn't it? Yeah. So I think it's one of them that as soon as people hear that, the ones who are like chatting in the concourses are thinking, right, get to seats quick, you know, and it builds. And if you know, you know, if the Pontians go bouncing with it and stuff, people are going to go, right, come on, not this, like, at the minute, it's kind of, oh, I'll get to my seat in another 5 minutes. Yeah, whereas that kind of stirs everybody to go, come on, right, you know, game on.
See, I agree with Ian. I shouldn't bother playing other three now. We're going with that one.
Right. This one was mentioned. Steve mentioned it as well, but it has been mentioned. It might not. I think what you're looking for is ideally lyrics that relate to football, Oakwell, Bath. I mean, there's not many besides Dave Cherry's Starfoot Roundabout song, which doesn't really get anything going. So I think listen maybe to the tune and see if something could be done with the lyrics. So number two then would be this one.
That's one of my favourite songs, eh?
Yeah. I knew this. Stop dreaming of the quiet life, someone will never know. Rip my father's run away fast, because rosy days are few. Stop apologizing. See, it does build up nicely, doesn't it?
You're going to sing now, aren't you?
What are you going to throw in there, Tom Cole Barnes?
Well, yeah, you see. I expected him throwing it in, but he let me down again, didn't he?
I think with that, if you do something about the lyrics, listen, I do like that iconic sort of start. I love the song, don't get me wrong. So from now on, it just goes worse, Ian, right? Let me just prepare you for this. I do really, really like this song. Title says it all. Steve?
I'm getting worried now. What this is
No. So this is another suggestion. This is Bon Jovi, and I love this town, or love this town. I always knew that starts a bit slow. This place. You don't have to look too far to find a friendly face.
Is it wrong that it reminds me of all the
It starts up, it kicks in a bit more in a bit. I mean, some of the lyrics, in fairness, that's why I love this town. It's, you know, it's, you could maybe do something with it or somebody that's quite...
Well, the bit where it says going down, down, down would be appropriate, weren't it?
Well, that's the bit for the opposition fans. And then we sing, that's why... Right, now, so there is one left. It's just about the lyrics, right? So don't make... Steve's already laughing. This is a song by a young lad who used to be in One Direction. And the clip I've got is actually he's singing at the concert because all... I know, they're all girls at the concert. They're sort of singing it. But when you listen to the lyrics, and they do need tweaking because it's not about laying next to each other. But I don't know. I
wow.
Right. Let me bring it up. I'm just... Anyway, it's probably the last time you'll ever hear this and see me on this podcast. So, I just, it's just about the lyrics, this for me. If the whole world is watching, I still next to you. Drive always and always to be there with you. Over and over, the only truth. Everything comes back to you. Can you imagine the Ponty? Yeah. Walk in the room, Now, I want you to remember, Sheffield United sing about a fucking chip butty, right? So let's just...
Yeah, it doesn't have to be groundbreaking, does it?
I think one thing with this, and it is difficult, you cannot compare anything to Blue Moon, no. You'll Never Walk Alone, because them songs are iconic and they've been singing them forever and ever and ever. So to start a new anthem...
I think what you have to do is you have to differentiate. There are some songs that are anthems in its own right. You'll Never Walk Alone is known worldwide, and they don't change the lyrics. They sing it, and it has a meaning for them. Great. Things like Blue Moon, they sing it. I'm Forever Blowing Bubbles, Chip Butty song. It's sort of the tune is there. They've made it about their club. And I'm not saying we should all sing Niall Horan songs. I love something that relates to our town or our club. I mean, all these, Monton's called obviously, well, Thunderstruck. There's a town called Mellis. I love this town and this town. And that's what I looked at. But how good would it be for the team to come out and 8,000 people singing? I mean, there will be people out there that can tune lyrics to make it about, you know, go and watch every time you play, whatever. I'm not a lyricist. Is that a word even?
I think you're right what you said, though. But on flip side to that, I can't ever see, and I'm not, you know, all due respect, but I cannot see 6,000 Barnsley fans in Pontyend singing two or three verses of a complex pop song. You know,
No,
it's
think
got to be.
The lyrics need to be changed.
Snappy,
simple,
quick, somewhat easy, and maybe same line three or four times over.
Exactly. And I think the club are obviously looking at it because one of the board members contacted is in Barnsley FC polls or whatever. I mean, they post a lot of polls, we retweet them. So I think it's something that they're looking at. I think they need to then help. If you get a group like the Rosa Dogs are saying, we'll have to record something, make the lyrics, you know, put them for the first couple of home matches, put them in the bottom corner of the programme or something. And I'm not saying we should, like Nessa Dorma, we should all learn Latin and start singing it, but some simple lyrics repeated two or three
times.
Can
you imagine that? Can you?
I can't do the eye bits.
I can't do any of them.
Stand on a chair.
But I just think they always talk about us being the 12th man. The 12th man's been missing for at least a season. And I think the 12th man can be there from the start if we just all get behind it. And everybody gets behind the team, but you can't. It's that clapping. It's like, I don't think it adds anything to the atmosphere. I think a song would. And we've had this discussion before with other people. And I know Timerider is bad. I think Timerider could be used in that minute and a half as they're coming into the tunnel. And then the moment they walk out, that gets faded. And a song, whether that be any of those or something completely different, starts playing. And I think that would really create an atmosphere. Some people will agree, some people won't agree. And that's fair enough, isn't it? Because that's football, that's life. But I think it would add to the atmosphere. If you haven't make a choice now, Ian, because you're on the board, we all know this. It's Thunderstruck, because the Thunderstruck is so iconic.
Yeah.
You put Barnsley FC in there, or you Reds, or whatever, you don't need to print any lyrics, because anybody, my wife could, no, maybe not my wife, my daughter would remember that. So, you know what I mean?
I think that would be a quick and easy win, while maybe a local band or somebody went away and thought of something that was more to do with the history of the town.
Yeah.
And or the club, if you could, like you say, some clubs sing about something that's really personal or talks about the club and intertwined with the town. Thunderstruck or something like that is a quick and easy hit, isn't it? That would get in the first couple of months, get people going in. I think something like that would catch on.
Yeah, I was also thinking, I didn't play it, but you know, Gala, Freed from Desire, we could just as an interim song, Free from Paul Conway. Because it goes, doesn't it? You know what I mean? I know he's still there, but he's not really there. Lads, I'm sure a lot will happen in the next coming weeks or months. The first friendly of the season is on Sunday, I believe, away at Worksop. I don't know if any of you is going down south, because we're expecting another grandson to be brought into this world on Thursday. Cesarean, that's why I know it's Thursday. So I'm going down to officially meet him. So I can't go. Ian, you have any plans to go to any pre-season friendlies?
I think I'm struggling for a couple of them, to be honest. I have a working at the weekends, or so yeah, I'll have to. I would like to have gone somewhere like that, just to good atmosphere, you know, and tick off a new ground. But fixtures are out Thursday.
Yeah.
So keen eye on them first to see who we get and when we get. But yeah, I wouldn't mind getting at least one in if I could, but I'll have to have a look and see what I can fit in.
Can we have a look at the fixtures and what which League One ground is closest to you, Ian? Don't say Barnsley, because
closest one is Bolton.
Bolton.
I've got like Aki, Fleetwood, and Morecambe are all close for me.
Yeah.
But then,
and have you got a spare bedroom? That's the next question.
Correct. Yes.
Steve Snowden, is that a problem?
I have earplugs, so it's no problem for me. but then my lad's like going, oh, hey, Dad, Portsmouth looks good, don't it? And so we've got family over in Lowestoft, so I'm like thinking, well, Ipswich would be good as long as it's not a Tuesday night or something.
Well, listen, Portsmouth, as Steve knows, my daughter lives in Gosport, which Portsmouth's Gosport, it's all the same, it's all down south. I've done that before as an away day and then an evening out on the Saturday, which is great when you're winning, when it's nil-nil, and the only points I brought back was 3 points on my driving licence because I did 8 on the motorway, but, you know. But there is some nice away days there. And maybe, Steve, you know, we could have an away day at Bolton.
Oh, yeah, I'm sure we can. I mean, when you renew your season ticket for all those people that are thinking about doing it, obviously, as a thank you from the club, you get a complimentary entry to the game on the 16th of July.
Fantastic.
Not been announced
Steve.
Yet, but they're trying to get, as far as I know, they're trying to get a Premiership side.
Is that so the one they're having like a bit of a family day? And is it?
Oh, it's all happening, mate. That day, it's all happening.
I think I'm out.
Yeah, but right. Unfortunately, I think I've got summit on that day, but I just can't quite remember what it is.
I'll tell you what it is, Steve. You're getting married to that day, mate.
Oh yeah. can we go at match instead then?
Yeah. No, because I've hired me soon now. And listen, lads, enjoy the summer, enjoy the warm weather. I'm sure it must be pretty warm at your end as well, because look at the colour on you, Ian. That's not just, you know what I mean? That's a lot better. I mean,
I'm just hoping it's not out in a bottle, that's all.
No.
And enjoy the rest of the week. I'm sure on social media there'll be plenty out when we have new signings, when players leave, but when the fixtures come out on Thursday. Hopefully catch up in about, you know, 3-4 weeks, definitely before the season, when we can have a look at the full squad and see what the realistic expectations are. But for now, Ian, thank you very, very much for joining us.
You're welcome.
Steve, mate, we won't see you again on here before you get married. So on behalf of all the listeners and everybody... no, I'm not saying, no, there is life after marriage. I'm just saying we'll record again before you get married. Steve, thanks very much, as always, and we'll see you, and we'll welcome you as a married man into our midst the next time we record.
That's something to look forward to, then, isn't it?
It's not so bad. I'm living my best life, but that's because my wife's away for a week. That's another question.
I think she doesn't listen to these.
She don't know how. Thanks very much for joining us this evening. This has been the Reds Report, and we'll be back in a couple of weeks' time.